Board members, closing comments? I'm sorry, not, I'm the wrong one. Forgive me. It's been a long day. I'm sorry. Item G, consent agenda. Board members, do you have items that you wish to pull?
Mr. Fair?
No, I have none.
I'd like to pull item 4.
Okay. Ms. Ortega? No?
No.
Ms. Zuno Vizcarra? 27, 28. I'd like to pull item 5. See nothing else. Is there a motion to approve the consent agenda with the exception of 4, 5, 27, and 28? Motion by Zuno Vizcarra.
I'll second that.
Second by Calderon. Any further discussion or comment? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Motion passes 4-0. Item 4.
Okay, accounts payable. I just have a couple. It's basically just questions on the accounts payable, page 2. You have AT&T $6,000 for services. That's, of course, that's for the month of July to August. Is that normally what we spend, given the fact that it was summer school and not all the schools were in session? Do we pay our phone bill? Is it a prorated system, or is it just a one lump sum that we pay a month? How does it go?
Good evening, board members. Carolina Rodriguez, business manager. The bill is only for August. And the open bill or the open PO for the whole year was made to $30,000. And so right now it's $6,000. I am going to look into it to see what I was looking at some of the charges. And this is not only for cell phone usage, it's also for the permanent lines at the offices.
Yeah, but what this here it says from July 1st to August 12th.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And in comparison to other years, I don't think that I can do that at right now because we went to a different phone system.
Okay. Okay. I also have a question on the that's our law firm, Atkinson and Loyola. Mm-hmm. That's 2020. Are we getting a detailed description of our fees? Or the fees that we are supposed to pay, or is it just?
The bill has a list of 11 items, and 10 of these items vary from $52 all the way to $3,000 for those three items. And there's one single item for $8,000, which was the board members' retreat.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay. We'll talk about that later. Also on the Calexico revolving, I guess that would be page 3, and mm-hmm. I see that the total is $8,900, but and I do see a couple of charges. For example, we bought those uniforms for those kids, students in need, and that's nice. I don't have a problem with that. However, the rest of that will be 1,026, 31, that will be 4. So the rest, the half of that amount almost is just the meals, meal per diems, credit card payments, all that. Who's using those credit cards?
The way that the revolving is being used at the time is sometimes in emergencies. If you see at the account lines throughout the pre-list, you see the correct resources being charged to. For example, 6512 is special ed, 7230 is transportation, 4035 is staff development. And what happens is that when there's not enough time for it to come on a timely basis, and they use the revolving as a means of making sure that we, that our processes continue, and that we're not, I mean, that things that needed to be paid get paid on time.
It's also like to make reservations for flight reservations, for conference registrations, et cetera, and that need to get done, and they need to get done immediately. That's how they get this done as well.
Okay, so because I see that there was another charge for, exactly what you're saying, that we need to pay for reservations and all that. And I do see, for example, there was another charge of for Ms. Montaño. So that was already paid. So we need to, yes, right there is the first charge. It's for $81.90. So what I'm saying is we need to be more proactive as to what is it that we are doing and what is it we're going to charge, because just looking at these credit card charges, it kind of worries me that we have open credit cards. Okay, and I know, I understand what you're saying, but when I see charges for $956 and it just says per diem or credit card payment, you know, I like to know what is it that we're spending that money on. Okay, mm-hmm. So, mm-hmm. I know we have to pay for conferences, and I do like the fact that we're sending a lot of our teachers and a lot of our administrators to conferences, especially next year that we're having this complete change in our system. I don't mind doing reservations in advance so we can save some money, because I know that happens when we do it in advance. However, I would like for it to be more clarity as to what it is that we're spending on, okay, especially with credit cards.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
I agree.
Okay. And last but not least, it would be, okay, Eric was not, it's not the last one, it's on page 8, Eric Hall and Associates, again, $4,000, is that, are they the consultants for the swimming pool? Is that what it is?
They are helping us with different projects, and this is not only the pool, they're also helping us with other facility, compiling information, making sure it's presentable to the Department of State Architects. And that's how they help us with meetings, with phone calls, and those are the various charges that they do to us.
Okay, I'll talk to Mr. Martinez in a minute. Later.
Hold on a second. Hold on.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Clarity. It's not my understanding that they're working with us on the pool. I just want that. Are they working with us on the pool?
No, they're not.
Thank you.
So then I need answers for that. Okay. And the last but not least, our electricity bill.
I was prepared for that one.
$140,000. I know we have to pay it, but.
Mm-hmm. And I'm going to go back to the previous bill, which you still had questions on. Mm-hmm. I went back and looked at the bills from last year. And to my surprise, we are paying a lot. We're paying less on various of the sites nowadays than we did the last year. And some of the examples would be Blanchard's, for example, just to give you an amount of that one. Last year, we paid $8,000 for this first for the same period, and this year we paid only $6,000. So in a lot of our sites, we did pay less. I did notice there were a few sites that had a big increase, and that would be the Deanza Gym and also Willy Moreno. And I'm thinking that's because of activities happening during the summer, that we need to have the gyms available to the city to provide these summer programs.
Okay.
So that was my findings, and as well also for this. So the total bill was for last month it was 144, and previous to that it was 140 last year.
Okay. So last year, okay.
Yes, and for this current period, for the month of July 13th through August 10th, the same. I saw a lot of sites paying a lot less, and then I looked into the kilowatts, the consumption. We also had less usage, and around the same number of service days.
Okay.
So, I mean, I think we're doing good. We're not overspending.
Okay, well, it's not overspending, but my question was whether maybe we were doing something out of the ordinary to get this charge. But if you're saying that that's the norm, that's what we've been paying, well, that's what we were paying.
Yes, so. And also, just to give you the numbers on the gym, which is the one that had the most usage, for example, last year, the gym at De Anza, we were charged $15,215 with 23 cents. This year, we were charged $21,000 with $49. Mm-hmm. So that is a big difference.
Yeah, well, the gym gets you, so.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so. And I mean, in the long run, it benefits our community. The kids get exercised and...
Oh, no, yeah.
It's a good thing.
Okay. I'm not going to argue about the gym being used. So.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That was my question.
Ms. Noviskara, do you have questions on the pre-list?
I do have questions.
Mm-hmm.
On page 2, under cash, it lists Ms. Randall, but Ms. Randall is not working right now. So it's did somebody go in her place, or we just...
Lost
out. It lists under cash under 012039, and it's a registration fee for Ms. Ambrisa and Ms. Randall. So was that past workshop?
Yes. Or? If you see that, that's a pay voucher. That is a liability. So the bill just came to us this year.
Thank you.
Oh, okay.
All right. Hold on a second. I saw that on page, I don't know.
The main one, on top right hand corner.
Page 4, bottom, sent us that we had first aid supplies for staff lounge. Does that come from the site funding?
That's from my department's funding.
Okay.
$7,300, yes.
Okay, and do you know if that same type of orders is happening at all sites?
I would like to think so, but I can look that for you and give you a listing.
Just a moment. In this pre-list, there's a number of... vendors listed in terms of books. I remember in the past we used to have Dr. Ayala, who was a board member, review it. Who is working together with, or who is ordering or reviewing what books are ordered, or how is it done? Do you know?
That would be Mr. Dr. Estrada in charge.
Oh, Dr. Estrada.
Any books that are being purchased right now are books that are already in our schools that are through our adoptions. It's whenever Dr. Ayala, and recalling the days of Dr. Ayala would review any new books that would come into the district, any new adoptions that would come into the district, any books that any literature books, even if they were reading books that the school sites would request. But anything, if I'm not mistaken, is with regards to what is currently on our adoption and that we need to supply our schools with.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And I think that's all I have at this moment. The only other thing that I would ask Ms. Rodriguez, right?
Yes.
Ms. Rodriguez, thank you for your report. Is maybe provide a legend for our board in terms of what, like for example, certain things are listed under a certain code for supplies or XYZ. You know what
you
I mean?
You mean like a chart of accounts?
Yeah.
Yes,
that
I will
could
provide
be provided.
You that.
That'll make it easier for them if they have questions to call you and review it over the phone or come in and talk with you and review
Certainly.
It.
Certainly. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I have
you.
No further questions.
Any questions?
No.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, item number 5, And that's agreement between CUSD and Spectrum Advertising for video recording board meetings. I'm sorry? Oh, I'm sorry. Is there a motion to approve the pre-list? No, we pulled it, remember? So now you have to go to it individually.
Yes, the pre-list. I'll make the motion to approve.
Motion by Calderon. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Zuno Vizcarra. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Motion passes 4-0. Item 5. And that was the agreement between CUSD and Spectrum Advertising. And I'm sorry I didn't ask you, but on the average, what are we spending on a monthly basis for the
and Mrs.
video recording?
Mrs. Burgos was able to secure that for me, and unfortunately, I believe I left it on my desk, but I want to say it's $15,000. What we spent for the whole year.
For the full year. And that's limiting it up to closed session?
Yes, they leave right at right before closed session.
All right. That's what I wanted to. Mm-hmm.
And just so you know, we asked for Spectrum to provide us how many times or how the frequency with which the videotaping is viewed. And I believe it's like an average of about 46 views on each one.
I know that it's also shown on our TV channel as well. It is. Okay, all right. And I have no further questions. Do you have any questions on this? Seeing none, is there a motion to approve number 5? Agreement between CUSD and Spectrum Advertising for video recording board meetings.
Motion
by Zuno Vizcarra, I'll second. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Is that aye, Mr. Galo? Yeah. So motion passes 4-0. Item number 27. Ms. Zuno?
Combined, 27 and 28, I have a question on both sections, summary of key issues, where it states spouses going along on the trips. I just want to ask if the spouses are, it's on, just not closing, if the spouses are fingerprinted, and is this just the norm? I understand that they go as for the female chaperones.
I will have to ask Mr. Pesqueira to respond to that.
Can you review that question, Mrs. Vizcarra, please?
Mr. Pesqueira, under the summary of key issues, it states that spouses of the coaches go on the trips and they serve as female chaperones. And my question is if the spouses are fingerprinted and go through the district's process of being allowed to travel, and you know, what I'm sure they're part of our liability at the point when they begin to travel with their teams.
I can tell you it's never been a practice. If we have chaperones, let's say for a band trip and so on, overnight trip. I can't tell you that we're going to get these chaperones, you know, through the system and fingerprint it before. Some of them are able to tell us a week or 2 weeks before the trip that they're going to be able to attend or not. So I don't think we've ever had that as a practice if we have a parent going as a chaperone to trips, or they go through the system as a request to process as being a parent volunteer.
So is there a difference between one going as a parent volunteer and or someone going as a coach's spouse? It'd be the same process?
Now, if the coach, well, I'm not sure if we've, go ahead.
Excuse me, I'm sorry, I just interrupted. Not even 5 minutes ago, I sent an email out that all chaperones need to be cleared as volunteers if they're going to be staying overnight with our students. That's a process that we will begin.
Sorry.
I don't know if you saw
it. And that's a process I'm going to follow then, because it wasn't in a practice in the past. Okay. But believe me, I will send all coaches. I'll go through the athletic director as well as the band director, as well as any other activity that if we're going to have to, if they're thinking of taking parent as chaperones or volunteers, we need to get those names so we can request to process these parents and put them as volunteer parents for our sites.
Okay. Thank you.
Was that for both of them?
Yeah.
So we'll go item by item. Is there a motion to approve item 27?
A motion to approve.
Motion by Zuno Vizcarra. Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Second by Calderon. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Motion passes unanimously. Item 28.
Same thing. That was the same aye motion.
Motion by Zuno Vizcarra to approve. Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Second by Calderon. Any further discussion? Seeing none. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Motion passes unanimously. Get back to. Okay. Item H. Superintendent recommends approval of following items. H1. And I have a request for oral communication by Mr. Chad Cooper.
You know, I know Ms. Burgos is very good at preparing my agenda, and not my agenda, but she shares it with me when she's prepared your agenda. But I left all my electricity's out of battery, all my electronics, and I'm looking around the room. I don't see a binder of the information the board has. And so in the future, I think we need to have the public a way to access the backup documents so we can speak with more clarity, because I'm about to go off of my memory, so I apologize if it's a little wrong. These three people here, I just want to preemptively strike, so to speak. These people are regular, fully credentialed teachers who've been asked by the district to teach outside of their area, and I've spoken with at least two of these three people. And they say they told their principal, assign me in an area that I'm qualified in. If you need me to teach in this other area, I'm happy to do it. Mm-hmm. But it's not a lack of credentialing on their part. So these are people going above and beyond their regular credential. And these aren't non-credentialed people working in the place of somebody with a credential. I'm afraid we may end up with cases like that down the road, which I'll speak against, but these people are quote-unquote the team player, okay? So that's for assignment 1, 2, and 3. The one that I can quote is David Gastelum, who has an elementary credential and is an all-star computers teacher, but he doesn't plan on ever going to school to become a computer scientist. And yet he's in there teaching intro to PowerPoint, which he loves doing, but county office for some reason wants him to become a computer scientist, and that's not needed for Excel and PowerPoint 101. So I'm speaking in favor of approving H1, H2, H3. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there a motion to approve H1?
I'm sorry.
I logged out.
I'll move to approve H1.
Motion by Calderon. There's a second.
Second.
Second by Ortega. Discussion. Any discussion, board members?
Maria, is these out of major assignments, these will be different than doing buying preps, right? Extend the contracts.
Yes.
Okay. All right. So and we're not in just so we don't get in the I went to Maria pays attention to me.
Excuse me.
just so we don't get in the in the habit, and I know because I know we sometimes these things happen where we need one period or two periods, and a teacher, you know, like Mr. Cooper says, they're being troops, and they're trying to help us. So, because I know when we started the school year, I think it started really well. I think it started way better than last year. So, last school year. So, I just don't want this to become a little notch on our back. So,
any further discussion, board members?
No, ma'am.
Okay. See no further discussion. Is there motion to approve?
There's a motion and a
second. I made a motion.
Okay. No further discussion then?
Not me.
Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Aye. Motion passes unanimously. H2, assignment outside of major for 2013-14 school year.
And motion to approve.
Motion by Zuno Vizcarra.
I'll second that.
Motion by Zuno Vizcarra, second by Calderon. Discussion?
No.
No. Okay, seeing none. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Motion passes unanimously. Item H3, assignment outside of major for 2013-14 school year. Is there a motion?
Motion.
Motion by Zuno Vizcarra. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Ortega. Any discussion? Seeing none? No discussion?
No.
Seeing none? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Motion passes unanimously. H4, 2013-2014 ABE teacher schedule proposal. And I've got Mr. Chad Cooper.
I did email the superintendent this morning about something regarding this, so maybe she has more information. What's here in your backup document describes hours that go outside of our contract, and what I requested a couple weeks ago when I was here was that we needed to write that up as an MOU. That way we could mutually agree to these unique hours. And ACT, to this point, has been left out of the process. So I just want to clarify that if you approve this as a proposal, it's just that, a proposal. Because if you say otherwise, I'm going to look at it as an imposition. And you're not allowed to impose new hours. Now, I do know AB is a unique program. I plan on fully supporting unique hours. As soon as we get an opportunity to talk, and I know there's a flood, several floods, etc. But just be careful bringing items that are negotiable to the board when you haven't discussed it behind closed doors. So in a way, you're giving away your poker hand. And number two, you're creating perhaps an oppositional environment that if I dislike something on here, then I'm going against something that the board did. When in reality, what I'd like to do is bring to you a mutually agreed upon schedule. And I can say, you know, please, admin and us agreed to this. Let's approve it. Because these hours here, for example, I don't know when the prep period is. And again, I'll take a little bit of the blame. I emailed Ms. Ambrise at my earliest convenience, which was this morning. Yesterday I was dealing a little bit with teacher concerns over the flood. So I don't know if the board's ready to vote on this as a proposal or if you think it's an imposition. Just my thoughts. And I'm going on record saying this. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cooper. Ms. Ambrise, before I call for a motion, is this a proposal?
This is something that was submitted to us by Mr. Moreno at our last board meeting. The board made a determination in terms of the positions and how many hours each position would hold. And so Mr. Moreno wanted there to be a reconsideration with the teacher A and B position in terms of the hours. So it could be viewed as a proposal versus an imposition. But I think Mr. Moreno wanted to kind of have a voice here in terms of why he wanted the teacher A and B hours to be voted on differently than what came up at the last board meeting. He has no opposition to the full-time hours for Mrs. Campos, for example, but he did want the board to view why he wanted the teacher A and B hours to be viewed differently. Mm-hmm. So,
and again, it's a proposal.
So I'll have Mr. Moreno address anything that he may have.
Honorable board and trustees and administration. First of all, I want to congratulate Coach Heck on his victory Friday night, his second victory of the 2013 season. And being the voice of the Bulldogs for the last 20 years, I haven't had a championship on the radio, but I look for one this year. I was just a kid in 74 and I was a coach in 93, but not on the radio, it's a different thing. Anyway, we'll look forward to that. And I did have summer school at my site. I had approximately the same amount of days as Calexico High School. In fact, the same amount of days. We went from 8:20 to 1:00. We offered requirements. We had Spanish this year. We started with about 145 kids, but we ended with about 120 or less for whatever reasons. And I'll give you full description on next time if you choose to. But the reason I'm here is historically ABE has offered classes in Calexico at hours that were available for the citizens. Classes were held in citizenship, classes were held in ESL, high school subjects for those students who cannot or did not get their high school diploma for whatever reason, and GED. Now, since I took over the program in 2009-10, we originally held it at the ABE Center next to Blanche Charles. They closed the following year, the facility. We had to move it, and I had to scramble around town to look for places to house my classes. We used San Diego State, we used Aurora High School, among other places. The following year, we, I believe, used the high school to teach at night. And the teachers who were teaching were part of the union. They were getting their teacher salary. They weren't getting paid by the hour. Up until 2 years ago, they moved to the present site where the De Anza Junior High ninth grade is. And then after that, they were not part of the salary schedule. And as a result, I believe they weren't part of the negotiations, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, I said I believe, so I'm not sure. But I know that they get paid hourly last year.
And where does that hourly come from?
Well, it comes from, okay. I'm just explaining the history, Mr. Cooper. So I was directed to make sure that, you know, we had a program based on what they could offer. So when we had a teacher that was approved to do her, you know, place so many hours, I think it's 30 hours or what have you, we still needed 24 more hours to provide instruction for the community. The proposal that was approved last time did not allow me to include high school subjects, because high school subjects requires 12 hours a week. So when the board approved the 3-8 hours instructors, I couldn't fit that in the schedule. State requires 12 hours a week. So we reviewed the possibilities and several proposals. We felt, and I felt, that this one would best serve our community. We have dwindled the program to what I'm looking at is two teachers, or, you know, one full-time, three part-time, whatever you want to look at it, from a program that was run by Mrs. Rendon with, I believe, 10 to 12 teachers at one time. So this proposal before you allows us to offer high school subjects, which is our biggest need, twice, with Ms. Campos teaching one high school subject because she's experienced in it, and then another teacher, we'll call Teacher A, to offer the high school subjects at a different time, at the same time. We've had experiences where if we offer high school subjects at night, the numbers aren't there. We've had experiences where we offer it in the morning, and the numbers aren't there. We felt that midday would be the best time because that's where we've seen the most numbers. And you know, in this case, we want the high numbers. ESL, we're offering in the morning. Traditionally, a lot of the ESL students are parents of the district. They want to learn English so they can help their sons or daughters with their work. We have three levels of ESL. We have beginning, intermediate, and advanced. A lot of our students are beginning. We have a few intermediate and advanced. So we kind of multi-level the classes, if you will. Is that my 3 minutes? No. I want to tell you that we did start on Monday, and we've got, I've seen the ESL in the morning. I haven't had a chance to go out there to see the high school subjects, but I know that there was a huge waiting list. And we are offering ESL in the evening, and we've seen a bigger number of gentlemen taking the ESL in the evening, whereas in the morning, we have a bigger number of ladies. GED is an important course for many students, but there's a high turnover. And even though we do have a waiting list, the GED is a challenging exam, which is approximately 6 hours long and includes reading, writing, science, social studies. Whatever you do in 4 years of high school is equivalent to a GED test. And there's quite a bit of preparation, and that's what our class for GED is allows us to do. But after further review, we felt that this particular proposal will best suit our students and our citizens in Calexico. And I hope I cleared up anything. If you have any questions, let me know.
Thank you. Board members, you have questions? Ms. Zuno Vizcarra?
Well, not necessarily a question for Mr. Moreno. I think as far as schedules go, I think it's great because, like you said, it serves the entire community in a schedule that works. I'm just really more keen about this being a proposal versus anything else because I agree with Mr. Cooper that it's my understanding that this hasn't been negotiated. That's mm-hmm. where I'm at.
So my follow-up question to Ms. Zuno Vizcarra's question is where then the next step is sitting down with the labor organization?
You meant me,
yeah.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
You said Ms. Zuno Vizcarra.
No, I said in addition to
my follow-up question. But I believe that what needed to be approved is
the proposal.
The board being willing to take two teachers versus, I believe the previous one had three in the part-time category. So instead of having three part-time teachers in addition to the full-time position, would the board be willing to consider the proposal at two part-time teachers, one obviously at the 18-hour and the other one at the 6-hour per week? And so I guess this is what's here, is to accept the proposal of two teachers versus two part-time teachers in addition to the full-time teacher versus
three
part-time teachers.
Well,
but that's not how this looks, because what we have is a schedule. And I think the argument is that the schedule is something that needs to be negotiated, and it's not negotiated. So in terms of a proposal, it should maybe be either a change in what we approved or an amendment to what we approved at last meeting, where we approved one full-time, three part-time. And maybe what Mr. Moroni needs is one, what he's proposing is one full-time, two part-time, and that's the way this should read.
I believe the approval of the last that was on your agenda last time was three teachers at 8 hours, which is equivalent to 24. This is 24 hours, teacher A and B. The hours have not changed as per the number of hours per instruction. The only thing is we've consolidated one to best suit the needs of the community.
Mm-hmm. And that's clear, just the way it's here with the schedule, it doesn't match.
But if I may add, it's just this proposal. And once again, if it's just as a proposal, it means that it could be subject to negotiations. That's the way that I see it. It doesn't say that this is the way that it's going to be. It says it just says proposal.
Yeah, you're approving a proposal and then go to the table and...
May I, Madam President?
You may.
Last year, we had 3 teachers at our site teaching 18 hours apiece.
Speak plainly. Is that what you want?
No. Well, we can't because I want more, but you're not going to give me more. You had 3 teachers that were teaching 18 hours apiece, and they had shared the high school subjects, right. ESL and GED.
Right.
2 retired, so we were left with 1. And that 1 is there on the top. And so we had she was given more hours. So we had to balance the last remaining hours amongst how we felt would be best. That site has 1 clerk. And one of the things that Dr. Spencer had reminded me last year, because she had taught adult education for years at the Central Union High School District, was, Mr. Moreno, when you're at Aurora High School and your clerk is there by herself, how do you plan to schedule it so that if something happens to her, you know, there's somebody there on site? So we rearranged it and we staggered the schedules. So whereas some teachers work Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, other teachers work Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and other teachers work Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Or depending on what they taught, it may have been, you know, 1 day, 4 days a week, depending if they taught high school subjects or not, which required 12 hours. So I had to work it out so that there was somebody on campus either teaching, and that's why we kind of worked it this way to where we were covered. I cannot be at both sites at the same time, although I'm glad it's there because it's pretty close to where my principal site is, which is Aurora. So if I need to go there, I will go there and I go back or what have you. But we felt that there needed to be coverage for the clerk. And she mentioned a good point. So if you notice, there is somebody there all day from Monday through Friday when the clerk is there, although it may be part-time, but there is. We've also included another teacher there, which has nothing to do with this, that is there from 8 to 3 Monday through Friday.
Any further questions? Ms. Zunovizcara?
I'm still stuck on the fact that what I've heard Ms. somebody say is not what's on here. We're proposing to approve something versus, I lost it, I'm sorry, this thing is frozen. The proposal, the schedule. So I'm all for that schedule, but it needs to be negotiated.
Well,
and I know it's labeled as a proposal, but the way somebody's described it was different than what's up there.
You approved 24 hours last meeting.
I understand that doesn't work for you.
That doesn't work for me.
And so we're here looking at something different. So this is different. But the way the schedule is laid out, it needs to be negotiated because the hours are...
Historically, teachers from ABE had taught at night from 5 to 7, from 4:30 to 7:30. They've had staggered schedules. We've even had classes at the high school where they worked at 4 o'clock or they worked at 6 o'clock in the evening. Never was that questioned by the union, nor was that changed. That was all, and they were full salaried employees back in that time when that was happening. So why are we hitting a roadblock when we have people waiting to get in class? Excuse me, Mr. Cooper. Can I finish?
Mr. Cooper. Hold on, Mr. Cooper. You'll get your time to speak. Thank you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
And so we have people waiting to get in class, and we would hope that, you know, this continue the way it has in the past. You know, I mean, not to step on anybody's toes or violate any contracts. I'm just saying that nothing was ever brought to my attention when I scheduled before. And so why is it being brought to my attention now?
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Cooper.
I don't know whether it's just violent unfair labor practice.
Can you please come to the podium? Thank you.
I don't stand behind John when he speaks. I feel intimidated.
Okay, I'll sit down.
Okay. You know, when I have my, thanks for laughing. I'll laugh later. When I have my ACT meetings, I don't invite the public to them. I believe you should have had this in closed session and not invited me there. Because now that you put it in public, you're back to this fairness issue. And that's the problem. 14 wrongs don't make a right. If the district or the union didn't follow the law in the past, we're not the legislature. I don't know if John was here or not, and he's a friend of mine. That's why I feel comfortable calling him John. I said, there's not going to be a roadblock to this unique schedule. I want to bring it front. And I'm not the one that dropped the ball. And I don't want to point the blame game, but we're wasting time when the district could have come to me, and I would have signed this off in a moment. Instead, I'm up here saying, well, if the union didn't follow the now I'm arguing laws. The law says this is a bargainable issue, not a consultation issue. I either have a demand to consult, demand to bargain. This, by law, is a bargainable issue. I don't know who was listening to me, but I think I said I don't see having hours that meet the adult schedule is going to be a roadblock. I think I just said that. In fact, I'll review the videotape. But instead, now I'm facing a possible unfair labor practice when one of your administrators is talking bad about my union. That's why we negotiate behind closed doors.
Okay, Mr. Cooper.
We go back to this kangaroo court issue. And kangaroo court is when decisions are already made. You allow administrators ad nauseum to come up here, give 20, 30-minute presentations, and yet when it's one of your loyal teachers up here, you're spiteful. And I just don't think that's a way to run a school district. I started out today with very good news. Enrollment's up. We're working together. I agree with Mr. Moreno that you need more adult ed teachers. But this is not the place to negotiate. You have not appointed yourself as agency negotiators. And I believe you're violating the law. I'm not a judge. Neither is a lawyer if the lawyer was here. So we'll have to go to PERB if I decide to go that route. I don't think that'll help the adult education system in Calexico flourish, though. So I don't believe I will do that. But I believe we would win. And then I'd be able to be in the newspaper waving a piece of paper, and it'd look like we were fighting with each other, when in reality I just want to work together. And we both need to follow the rules. Okay? Please, schedule a meeting. We will get this taken care of. But your parameters for negotiating, that needs to be done behind closed doors. And you need to give your negotiator latitude so we can reach a compromise, not imposition. I'm not going to fight about this. I want more adults to be here. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Board members, what is the wish of the board?
I just think this is quickly resolvable with a meeting with ACT and the district. So it's my recommendation that this be tabled.
Okay. Motion to table and give direction to schedule a meeting as soon as possible. Is there a second?
Schedule a meeting for
with
something next week.
You could just come back to the next board.
You're going to meet with ACT and negotiate this, and then we come back to approve this next week.
That, or we can, if we're able to have a meeting with Mr. Cooper and.
There'll be three of us at the meeting, yeah. And just my schedule will work with whatever they do.
Okay. We could bring this back to the 24th.
Okay.
I'm sorry, I don't.
So motion by Zeno Vizcarra, second by Calderon. Any further discussion?
I just don't like putting off the starting of services.
Well, perhaps if everybody's motivated to meet and move forward, perhaps we can have a special meeting and move forward on it and not wait till the 24th if everybody's available.
If you've hired personnel.
That is my only question. Show me where their prep time is.
We have a motion on the floor. Thank you. We have a motion on the floor. Is it second? Is there any further discussion by board members?
Well, I'm with Mr. Calderon. I wouldn't want to put this off any further either.
Okay. Seeing no further discussion, all those in favor signify to table, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Moving on to number H5, new job description, instructional assistant music. Do we have any further? Ms. Ambriz or Mrs.?
Mrs. Armendariz will come forward on that.
Thank
one.
You.
Good afternoon. We're bringing this new job description to the board, hopefully for approval. And this is going to be to assist us in our not only zero period, but for at least 3.75 hours at Calexico High School, and it will start at 7 o'clock in our Calexico High School marching band. We've already met with CSEA yesterday, and they have also approved this job description. So now I don't know if you have any questions regarding the job description, but it is going to be for Calexico High School.
This a part-time position?
Yes, part-time, 3.75 hours.
I did have questions in terms of the range.
The range 18?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. We discussed that also yesterday with CSEA, and they've approved it. We met with, it was Mrs. Washington. We met with Mr. Rodriguez, Emilio, and Sonia Redona.
What would be the difference, Ms. Armendariz, between the 18 and I think it's a 14A? Can't see that far. There's an instructional assistant at a 14A.
I don't have that information. I see that Mrs. Washington is standing over there. I don't know what the difference is between the ranges.
Yes. Nikki Washington, Director of Human Resources. Actually, Esther Martinez did some research with surrounding districts in the area to see what they're paying their instructional assistants for music program. And it kind of, we're comparable with what most districts are paying. And currently, in terms of the classification for instructional assistant, they're in range 18. And when we met with CSEA, those were some of the factors that we looked at, and both parties agreed that range 18 was appropriate.
For specifically for music assistance?
Yeah, for music and for just the general instructional assistant classification, that particular classification. Because you also have the special ed, I don't have my glasses on, and the behavioral that fall under that classification.
So what you're telling me is that the instructional aides at other school districts were at 18?
What is it?
Well, it may be 14? A different range, but in terms of the dollar amount, we're somewhat close.
Okay.
Yeah.
Same, different range, but same amount.
Right. Except for Beverly Hills, which paid like $20-something dollars an hour, but that's a different labor market.
Okay.
But the other districts, were, it was pretty comparable.
And the difference might also be related to the fact that it's specifically within organized music setting and music theory?
Yeah.
Okay. I have no other questions.
Thank you.
Mr. Noviscara, do you have additional questions?
No, I was trying to compare it to a job description out of a 14A, but I didn't get that in time. I didn't ask for it in time.
What was your question, maybe?
Well, what are the differences in job duties between the 14A and the 18? Is it just that they have to have a music background?
Mrs. Martinez will address that.
Good evening, board members. Hester Martinez. The instructional aid position is not as specialized as the range 18, which are severely handicapped or behavioral, and now the recommendation is for music. There's a specialty assigned to the instructional aid. In other words, the commission requires more preparation because of the duties that the district is requesting that this person does.
Can you give an example? Like, for example, I know, like, for example, we have certain
instructional assistants, plain instructional assistants, assist a teacher in instruction only. That's pretty much it. Instructional assistant for special ed have to also assist a student with learning, what's the correct word, disabilities. And for severely handicapped, it involves toileting, behavioral. It assists students with emotional and behavioral problems. And in this case, music focuses specifically on music. They have to come in with a background in music. So instructional aid range 14 is pretty much assisting an instructor without any necessary required specialty.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Any further questions?
Ms. Aguilar, one more thing that I do want to add also is the number of students in this classroom, too, versus our classrooms, either 30 or 34. Right now, Calexico High School, we have 159 band members for zero period.
Okay. Any additional questions?
No, ma'am.
Seeing none, is there a motion to approve the new job description? Motion by Calderon. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Ortega. Any further discussion, board members? Or questions? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion passes 4-0. I'd like to call for a 5-minute recess for a restroom break. We will now resume school board meeting. We go on to item H6, salary schedule for instructional assistant music. And that'll be Nikki or Esther. And so it already kind of went over it. Is there any further questions, board members? No. It's Ortega?
No.
No. Is there a motion to approve?
I move to approve.
Motion by Calderon. Is there a second?
Second.
Motion by Calderon, second by Ortega. No further. If there is no further question, I'd like to call for the vote. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. No. Three yeses, one no. Moving on to item H7, request for board approval, surplus of assets, non-asset items. And that is Carolina.
Good evening, board members. What this resolution is all about is to properly dispose of any obsolete items within our district. It could be, there's a list. Can you pull out the list, please? Some of the items are at Jefferson Elementary, and also modular trailers are also part. There's another list besides that one. And to properly dispose of these items, we have to go through the procedures of doing approving a resolution.
Okay. Are there any questions, board members?
So once again, what I'm reading is all these items are obsolete because they're broken and no longer usable.
That is correct.
So no longer usable for teaching.
Yes, their value has depleted completely, depreciated completely, and they're not usable to our standards. Or the other issue would be to donate them. Maybe again because they depreciated completely, we've replaced them with new furniture or with new items. So these items might be still be usable, but they could be donated to a non-profit organization.
Okay, that was my question.
Go ahead.
Yeah, there's also modular buildings included in here as well.
That is correct, and these modulars have also been valued. They've done a value analysis on them, and at this point, it's not cost effective to go through the advertisement of trying to sell these modulars. It would be more expensive to do all that than the value that they are really worth.
Yeah.
Okay. Are there any further questions, board members?
I don't.
I see Mr. Martinez coming this way. Did you want to provide some follow-up background info?
Yes, just to add something there, Raul Martinez. In regards to these modulars, the modulars that we're talking about are more the mobile home type that have axles under them. And which ones are they? At Willie Moreno, at that fenced-in area, there's some that we removed back when the earthquake hit. These type of mobile homes, I'll use that word, the mobile homes, to describe them differently from the modular buildings, classrooms that we actually have at all the sites. The state no longer will let us use them for educational purposes as of 2015. So one is we'd already disposed of them, and now we have those. There's six modulars. More pieces than six, right? But some are two pieces put together, and some are three pieces put together. But in addition to those six buildings that we have there, we also have a mobile home at Mains Elementary that we can't use anymore for educational purposes. And then we have one at Kennedy Gardens that's a triple wide there. Both of Mains and Kennedy Garden are triple wide that we can't use students in them anymore. So we also want to surplus those. There's another one that's at Kennedy Gardens that belongs to someone else. That would be the, who is it? Migrant, is it Campesinos Unidos? I'm sorry, but it doesn't belong to us, and we're trying to have them remove it from the premises too. But those are the mobile homes that we're talking about.
Okay. I do have a question in regards to that one. I know, I'm sorry, Carolina. In terms of that one that you're mentioning, that the migrant, not migrant, it's Campesinos Unidos. Correct me if I'm wrong, but they're basically wanting nothing to do with it, but they don't want to use it, but they don't want to remove it either.
When I was researching this, I spoke to them, and apparently they are saying that there is a resolution saying that they gave it to us. So I asked them for a copy of the resolution because we can't start removing it or disposing of it if in fact it's not really ours. So I haven't received the resolution. Mm.
Did they state when that resolution took place?
No. No, they just said that they believe that.
I don't think it has been in the last 4 years.
No.
So either they need to submit another resolution or some type of a release for us, I guess.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, that's all the question that I had.
Thank you.
Anything else, board members? Okay, seeing none, is there a motion to approve? Motion by Zuno Vizcarra, is there a second?
Second.
Second by Ortega. Any further question or discussion by board members? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Motion passes 4-0. H8, approval of resolution adopting the GAN limit for fiscal year 2012-2013. Ms. Rodriguez?
Yes. What this is a resolution that needs to be adopted every year. to place limits on the growth of expenditures for publicly funded programs. This is a measure by Proposition 4 back in 1979. So part of our unaudited actuals reporting requires that the GAN limit be established and board approved. So that's why I bring this one before you.
So this is something that we do every year, correct?
That is correct.
Correct. Board members, any questions?
I don't.
No, no questions?
No.
Okay, seeing none, I'd like to call for a motion to approve. Motion by Zuno Vizcarra, is there a second?
Second.
Second by Calderon. Any further questions or discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Motion passes unanimously 4-0. Item I, board members' closing comments. Mr. Ortega.
None at this time.
Mr. Calderon.
Well, I visited some of the schools and I've talked to some of the principals and assistant principals and teachers at the various schools, and it seems like the opening of the school year went pretty well. As with any organization, there were some stuff, there were some issues. However, nobody's perfect. So I'm really pleased with what I saw, and I'm really pleased with what the reports were from the sites that I visited, and then the sites that the principals and the people that I talked to. So also I'm really pleased to hear that our city is still up after Saturday's events. And I'm glad I don't think I heard any fatalities or casualties. So I feel pretty good about that. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Zuno Vizcarra?
Yeah, you know what? One of my comments was that I appreciated the summer school reports. I didn't want to mention that we didn't get one from Aurora, and I know I think Aurora also had summer school, and it would have been nice to have had a report from Aurora as well. And I do also want to commend the classified employees for all the work that they did during the storm and all their efforts to get our school operational and clean those pathways. I had the opportunity to go with Ms. Ambriz to Blanche Charles this week, and it was nice to see all of the work. Ms. Armendariz was there, Mr. Martinez was there, Ms. Ambriz was there, and I got to see firsthand all of the efforts, and really more than anything, the kids were so well behaved, and they were carrying their chairs and just looked really happy, and they were not bothered at all by what was going on. But you really saw a lot of running around by the adults. Ms. Moniger looked like she could have used a break, and I was like 8 in the morning. But I want to commend every school and every administrator and every teacher and even the students for pulling together during the storm. And lastly, I'm really excited about our enrollment growth. I'm glad to see that our schools are sort of rebuilding and students are coming back, or students are either re-enrolling or we have new enrollment. So it's really, really exciting for this district. I think we've done a lot to attract either students that had left or whatever it is everyone's doing, and really you all get the credit for everything that you're doing. It's exciting to see that enrollment growth. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll also add my support to the comments made by board members. I didn't have a chance to be there when there was enrollment at the high school, and had good conversation with Mr. Piscata and some of the staff. And so obviously, sometimes there's some issues that need to be worked out, and I look forward to making the process easier all around. I do want to commend publicly and very gratefully Mrs. Ambriz and Mrs. Armendariz for their hard work. Everybody worked, but I really want to thank you for stepping up to the plate on Saturday our city asked for wanting to collaborate. I want to thank Tito for showing up and helping me man the cool center out at William Moreno. I'm very, very grateful that our community didn't suffer any fatalities. We got hit by a storm that was not a normal storm, and we were lucky that we didn't have any loss of life. Let's keep working together and keep on trucking, I guess. Ms. Ambriz.
There's one thing that I didn't mention earlier. It was really interesting to be able to go out there on Saturday night and work with the CERT, the Community Emergency Response Team. And number one, I'd encourage any member of our community that would like to be a part of CERT to seek out how to get trained or to get trained and be a part of it. I think it's a worthwhile organization to know that entity to know that our people within our community are willing to step up. You know, to see people showing up at 11 p.m. at 12 p.m. I was Ms. Armendariz and I were there till 1:30 in the morning at the police station, and there were people showing up with their bags and their vests at 1 a.m. So I thought, you know what? Wow, that's something to be a part of. And the other piece is that we obviously got to know our local municipal agencies, such as the police department and our fire department. And it was good to work with both entities, but I want to give a special shout out, I guess, to our fire chief, I think that's his title, our fire chief, Peter Mercado. What a fine gentleman. And you know what? I know that his father was, I never met his father, but his father was a fire chief when he was alive. And I shared with him privately that I believe that his father would be proud to know how he is now leading the fire department. And I feel as a citizen of Calexico that we are in very good hands when we have somebody of his caliber leading our fire department. So thank you.
Your comments triggered something. I even printed it out and I forgot. In terms of, I did a little bit of research myself, and we may want to consider looking at the format that Brawley is following in terms of how they're staffing, having a school resource officers. They've hired retired law enforcement, and they have this is how it is. There are two police officers currently employed, and they have two shifts, one officer in the morning and the other one in the afternoon, overlapping at lunchtime. Both are currently not armed on campus and are waiting for a new policy to be placed in the district bylaws. The state of California says that all schools must remain gun-free. However, the law supposedly states that the district has the discretion to adopt a policy that retired officers in good standing can carry guns on campus. This is the Brawley district.
Would this be Brawley Elementary or Brawley Union High School district?
I think it's Brawley Union High School, but in our case, we're a unified. So anyways, I'll pass on the email. I did touch base with some people, and this is another option besides the ones that you mentioned earlier. Thank you.
I was just going to add to that there's also a grant available by the Department of Justice. I believe it's called COPS, that they issue a grant for about $250,000 for two police officers as well.
That's how we originally started.
Oh, really?
So you're telling me that's come back?
Well, there was one issued this year, and it was issued in Oceanside from the research that I've been doing. Okay. Now, that application process closed, I believe, in April, but I think it's subject to open again next
year. Good
to know.
So
I think that, they in Oceanside is where they issued.
Perhaps we can give direction to our grant writers to...
From what I was reading, it seemed like it's at the city level or the police department level where they'd apply for that, but I don't know.
Yeah.
You know, that's okay. Further research, but yeah, that's out there as well.
Okay. Thank you. Uh-huh. Well, Ms. Sombris, will you do the announcement of convening to closed session, please?
Okay, we'll convene into closed session. We will do the items of public employee appointments. and employments, public employee discipline, dismissal, release, non-reelection, and then after that, reassignments, and then we will reconvene into open session after that. Thank you.